So let's start for the second part of the lecture, or the second lecture of the day. So I told you that now we have a nice isotropic hardening model that we love much, and I will show you an application right after this kinematic part. I will show an application to nano-annotation, and you will see that indeed this is a very nice model, and we see that the physics is inside. But first I want to tell you what if we put kinematic inside, because kinematic is missing. So what should we do to add kinematic hardening? So to do that, first I like you to know exactly what is kinematic hardening. So I don't know if you are aware of what it is. So if we speak, for example, of the G2 approach, you know G2? G2 is the von Mises approach. So you take the square root of the trace of the deviatoric part of the tensor, and you compare to the yield stress, and you say you will have flow law as soon as this is positive. Okay? So G2, it looks like that. If you take the invariant of the stress tensor, sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, the von Mises curve, the yield surface looks a big cylinder. It means that it is pressure independent. It doesn't take care of the pressure. It's a purely shear criterion. If you are dealing now with a single crystal, like crystal plasticity, this is replaced by some planes. You have some planes here which define your normal and your Burgers vector direction, but it's similar. It will still be invariant with the pressure. We are still only a shear model. So I will just focus on von Mises to make it simple. So you have your yield surface. If you see on top of it along the 1-1-1 directions, you can see this as a circle, which is your initial yield stress. It means that if I pull on tension up to that stage, I will have plasticity. So this is all the point where, depending on my loading, I will get plasticity. Okay? This is basic, but I want to be sure that you get it. Now, if I take back the curves I already showed you a few days ago for my 3 stainless steel, the polycrystalline sample we are pulling on, here we were able to measure the yield stress, sigma y, epsilon y. So this falls into my criterion like this. So this is my yield stress. Okay? So if we want to use a G2 model, what they do usually, at each of the points here, they measure a new, they use a new yield stress. So they say that, okay, the yield surface has increased. Okay? It's increasing your yield stress because of the new yield stress that you get here. This, this, and this. Okay? So this is what we call isotropic hardening. It means that although I am pulling along a given direction, let's say here it's sigma 3, the tension, okay, I assume that the behavior is the same along 1 and 2. So this is isotropic hardening. Your yield surface is increasing with time. Okay, this is exactly what the model I showed you is exactly that. You have your tau mu, which is always increasing. It cannot decrease, actually. It can only increase. Okay. Now, on contrary, you may have the kinematic hardening, like this, which says that, okay, you have your yield surface, like this. Then when you move to the next step of your tensile curve, it is just a shift of your curve. So you can assume that the surface is a constant, so you don't always have this constant yield surface, but it is just translated because of your load, like that, like this, and then like that. Okay? So this is a purely kinematic hardening modeling of the same quantity. And if you put the two in the same equation, in the same model, you can write two different models, one which is purely kinematic, one which is purely isotropic. You will get exactly the same curve like that if you are doing the tensile test. The difference will be when you unload. When you unload, things will be totally different. When you do what we call a Bochinger test, things will be different. Typically, if I am at that stage here, if now I'm unloading, I unload my specimen, when I reach that stage, I will be plastic again with this kinematic model. And then I have a new yield point and I will have plasticity. So this is kinematic. Kinematic hardening means that now the yield point in compression is a lot smaller. Actually, here it's even negative, smaller than the yield point in tension. So you have a change of sign of your yield point. It's not an absolute value. It's not symmetric curve, you see, like that. So this is a kinematic hardening, and we define out of that the mean distance between the two, so the center of this point here, which is x, and this is what we define as the kinematic hardening stress. Okay. Okay for that. Now, to come back to the isotropic. So this is the kinematic. It's like that. If I would do the same for isotropic, it would be like this. Isotropic. It means that I have the same stress on load than unload. So you see that now, if you change your path, things are totally different. You see? If you are monotonic, you can mimic exactly the same behavior using each of the model. Now, if you are doing some cycling loading for fatigue, for example, or for Bollinger test, then those two are completely different. Okay? Although they try to be the same. So now, if we, in reality, what is the reality? The reality is just between the two. There is a part of kinematic and a part of isotropic. Material behave the two at the same time. And typically, how we can do implement that in a model, you would just say that now the yield surface is not F of sigma only, it's F of sigma minus the kinematic stress. You just remove the kinematic part of the stress inside your yield surface. And again, you can use a G2 model, for example, like that, where you compare to the yield stress. And then you need to define the evolution of the stress rate, the stress, the kinematic stress, how it evolves with the plastic. It can be, for example, this term, which linear and nonlinear term, as I showed you before, similar to Azaro paper, for example. This is a typical hardening model, for example, proposed by Chaboch. Okay? And for that, you will be able to simulate, for example, cyclic loading. Only things that here you need to do is to fit these parameters C and lambda out of experiments, typically one or two cycles of fatigue, and then you will get this value, or the saturation cycle for fatigue will give you the value for the C. Okay? But now if we want to account for kinematic hardening in our model, it's not so easy in the dissociation density based law. We did some trial. We have this paper in 2008 with Christophe Després, where we tried that. This was only valid for fatigue. So the idea behind, I don't have time to explain the model here, but the idea behind was it was fatigue. So we considered the fact that dislocation stopped at pileups. And since they stopped at pileups, there was a gradient of deformation, a gradient of displacement. So it's a second order gradient, if you want. So you have a gradient of deformation between and after and below before the pileup. And from this gradient, we were able to measure the stress. And this gradient depended only on the height of the dipole. You should have a look to this paper actually, because you know what is the dipole. Now we computed that. So the height of the dipole was the strength of the kinematic hardening. And we had an evolution of this dipole using DD. So we had the full things and we were able to do fatigue tests. But this was really dedicated to fatigue. It could not be adapted to something else. It was still a kind of thing because we are dealing with dipoles. And in reality, things are much more complex because it depends on boundary conditions. I will show you a few examples of that. Typically, this one that we also met yesterday, you remember this Oro 1 looping to bypass a hard particle, let's say a precipitate. This is not something which is isotropic, this is a kinematic hardening because here the positive dissociation are coming, they are piling up, so they repel. But if I was unloading, unfortunately, I didn't unload here. I should do the simulation. If I am loading, you know that this dislocation will come back here. Those loops will still be there. And when it will come back to the loop, it will annihilate. So it will be very easy to move through. So the yield stress to unload will be a lot lower than the stress to load. Okay? So this will be a pure kinematic model just because of the precipitate. But this is only valid for precipitate. So if you want to do that, you can make a model and so on. It will be valid for that. And more or less, you have more parameters. For example, here, if I take a single crystal, I put a source on it, you can see the stress level there. I pull, and then I unload, so I try to make a Bollinger test. You see how it behaves. The loop is coming back for a zero stress, more or less, a very small stress which corresponds to the pyrrole stress. And then it's shrinking down that way, like this. The loop is dead, like this. And then you need to apply another stress to go back on the negative. So your cycle looks like that. It will be like a plateau to reach the yield. This is a force control test. And then like this. So this is your cycle. You see? So the cycle in the case of a single crystal, an infinite grain. It's an infinite grain. Okay? No obstacle. Now if you have obstacles, it's not the same. You have your dislocation, which is emitting loops. And when it emits loops, there is a pileup at the boundary. The pileups create a back stress on your dislocation loop, so it is harder to move it. So it means that with time, you can see that now it's not a plateau. Here it was a plateau stress. Here there is a stress increase. This is a hardening. This hardening is typically a kinematic hardening. It means that if I unload here, when I am unloading, I have some plasticity very quickly. The plastic is not starting there. It's not isotropic. It's purely kinematic. You see, this is a kinematic hardening. And this is what we call a linear kinematic hardening, which can be computed very easily out of pileup theories. And I think today in the exercise, we will make a free dislocation pileups this afternoon, typically to illustrate this. Okay? So you see the difference. So you cannot say that kinematic hardening is here and is here and not there. It's complicated. It depends on your boundary. So this is typically the first thing, the boundary dependent of this. And very recently, so this is the PhD which was defended last year, we also investigated the effect of the particle shape, the grain shape. So if your grain is spherical, if it's elongated or very much elongated, the back stress, the kinematic hardening stress, is also changing. So you see that all this now, to make this in a model, in a FEM simulation, is quite complicated. So today, at least in our group, we are not able to do something satisfactory, in the sense that it's not something physically based that will work in any case. It's always something which is dedicated to a given application that we can do. So I will not give you all the cases and all the possibilities, because it's always different. Okay? So this is why I don't have it today. So today, if you want to have a kinematic hardening, I would advise you to compute GNDs, typically, so the gradient of the deformations, and to put it in your model and see how your hardening depends on the GNDs, because dislocation densities, geometrically necessary dislocation densities, and this will give you a way to put kinematic hardening in your model. But this depends on your problematic. If it's a grain, you will have all patched naturally with that. If it's a fatigue, then you need to compute GNDs out of the dislocation cells, so you need to put that inside. If you are precipitates, you need to compute GNDs out of the OR1 loops, so you have to make another model of that. You have to adapt. Okay. So that's my conclusion on that for the kinematic hardening. So before going back, I just want to highlight also one more effect, because I had a nice discussion at the break. I'll go back to the equation, because there are no more, maybe they are here. Yes, the equations are there. I just want to highlight one more thing. One more thing is that this model has no size effect. There is no length here. There is no length in my equation. It's totally length independent, like FEM, like von Mises code. You can increase by 10. Everything is the same. Okay? So there is no length here. So you don't have hole patch with that. Typically, the hole patch mechanism, you know, the stress which depends on the size of your grain, is not getting out from that loss. But you can do that very easily. If you are interested in size effect, this model is very easy to change. This we did it. You just need to change the mean free path here. Remember that the mean free path here is this one, square root of rho over k. So this is a length, lambda, that was in my equations. So this was the distance dislocation should move in order to get stopped in the specimen. If now you have a grain boundary, you can add another distance in that equation that would be your distance from your Gauss point to the grain boundary. And this distance to the grain boundary is not the same for every Gauss point, will give you an extra hardening here that will naturally lead to the hole patch mechanism. So it's very easy to, not with gradient theory, it's still not kinematic hardening, okay? It's not a kinematic mechanism, but you will have the size effect in your model using that feature. You just make a new, you can say that the mean free path, the inverse of the mean free path is the inverse average of the two mean free paths. And you put it that. Many people are using that actually. So this is just to show you that you can put some length effect, size effect in this model very easily. Okay? So did you get this idea? So kinematic hardening, I will not give you a general law as I did for the isotropic hardening, because it will not be valid in any situation. And if you are interested in fatigue, I would advise to look at this paper. Okay? So now, anyway, we have this model. It's not a bad model, we think. It's just isotropic, but we can use it in monotonic deformation. If you are just applying something monotonic, it should work. So this model is based on dislocation densities. We use the OR1 equation to get the flow law. We use the Taylor relationship to get the hardening law. We use some balance of density to get the evolution of dislocation densities. Okay. So the physics is there. The physics is there. We are happy with that. But the parameters are not so easy to compute, because we made some average. So it's not the same as the parameters from a single dislocation motion that we used for the initial equation. So we have to do something to identify those parameters. So either we can do that with experiments. You can make some jump tests to compute all the different parameters, or inverse methods. So you can make many, many simulations to fit a given experiment. Or you can do simulations. And I will show you that with discrete dislocation dynamics, since the physics is there, we can compute the parameters. Okay? So this we will see tomorrow. Anyway, let's apply the model to something very simple, a nano-indentation test of single crystal. So we'll make some nano-indentation experiments and compare if the model can reproduce or not the experiments, depending on the parameters we can put in the model. So this is how it will look like. We will use such a mesh, a 3D mesh, of course. It has to be 3D because the symmetry of the crystal is not, there is no symmetry. Okay, the symmetry is the threefold symmetry. And here we will use a 1-1-1 indentation, first of all, or 1-0-0 indentation. So we select several axes, possibly, for this normal here. It's a single crystal, so you can select how is orientated your crystal inside your mesh. It's a highly refined mesh. You can see that locally the mesh size is very small compared to the indentation. And the indentation is taken as a sphere, okay, like that. We put that law, so those laws we know in the model. And this is the parameters we will use. So the first thing we do with FEM is very easy to handle anisotropy. So we will take into account the fact that the system is not isotropic. It's elastically anisotropic with these parameters here for copper. This is for copper, okay? So this is from textbook. You can use this Cauchy tensor. Then the model is based on dislocation densities. So you need to say how much I have at the beginning of my simulation. What is the initial dislocation densities for all the 12 subsystems? So that's the parameters and how to measure that. So Professor Sundararaman showed you that we can compute dislocation densities, but if you need to have TM specimen and look at it, and then you do your nano indentation, it's not so funny to do. So what we did here, so I will use several orientations. Maybe I should go to that one to explain you. I should have reversed this. This is the one. My samples are the following. This is my sample I'm using. So it will be two specimens that we took in our lab. One has been cut by spark erosion. So it contains a few dislocations inside because of the preparation stages. And it was from a single crystal. So we were able to have some faces which were nicely orientated along 110, 001, and 111. Okay, with a density which is, I would say, high density because of the spark erosion mechanism to prepare the sample. Okay, then we had another sample, which was like this. So you have also the 111 orientations and the 1-2-bar-3 orientation of this specimen, but this was a Bridgman specimen, so very low dislocation density. So that's very nice for this model because it means that you have 1, 2, 3, 4 orientations. Okay. For the same material, a copper, and two orientations are the same, but with two different densities, high density and low density. So we can use it to check the model very easily. So it was a very nice experiment for that. 4 surface orientations and 2 dislocation densities for this orientation here. Okay? So these are my experiments. So I will go back to the slide, which should be there, actually. So now if I put that in my model, What I did is for all the orientations, so the 01, 111, and so on, the low density and the high density, what I do is I can make some X-ray measurements, and we can measure the full width of half medium peak, the length of this peak, to get a relative value of the density. It's not the absolute value, but we have an idea of the content of defects in the sample. So, for example, if we say that this one is 1, we know that this one is 5 times lower. We know that this one is 4 times or 3 times bigger. This one is between 6 and 7, 8 times bigger. So this was computed out of X-ray pattern, okay? So we don't know the initial density exactly, but we know the ratio. Now from DD, we can compute the parameters of the model. So the model, I remember you that there are these parameters, the matrix here. We have the same matrix there, or another matrix there, I would say. An annihilation here, and then K here. So those are the parameters of the model, more or less. So here we tested several parameters. Mine, which was very stupid thing we did, you see, so many years ago. So this was my PhD thesis. At that time, so I did the first DD simulation on this kind of thing. very roughly, so it was not very nice. But I found that the parameters, if you take this out, they were more or less all the same, 0.009 inside. But there was a very small difference at that time in my model. So if you take it out, it will be 0.3. So it's 0.3 mu b square root of total dislocation density. But that's a good average, anyway, of what happens in reality. But more recently, Cuban and co-workers, in 2008, they computed again the same parameters, but much more precisely than what I did. And now the power of the computer was also a lot better. And they found the different parameters, different coefficients, depending on if it was collinear. So the collinear is this guy. Okay. If it was a Lomer-Cottrell, and then this was Earth, and this was maybe the collinear, the coplanar. Okay. So they measure these parameters. I will show you how tomorrow they did that. Okay. Then for K, again, I did that during my PhD. I computed out of the dislocation density evolution curves. I was able to fit this law and find what was K. And I found something where is it for me? K here, 100 or 36. What is normal? 36. Yeah. Okay. Here, well, yeah, here now we have also two more parameters for this expression. So A is this matrix. So this matrix, either we take the same as the red one, this matrix, the same as this, okay? And K was 36. This was proposed, this 36 was my proposition, and this we put it here. So we put the same parameters as the Hardy matrix plus K equal to 0.6, or we put this value. What are these values? These values were proposed by Franciosi. I don't know if you know this work. Franciosi in the 70s was the first guy who was computing the forest hardening component matrix. So he computed this interaction matrix. And this was the matrix he proposed at that time. And then we also test a last example where K was increasing a lot, just to check the effect alone of K. So same parameters, but just K is changed. So you see many, many parameters. And we will see what this change in the behavior in nano-indentation. So let's go for the modeling. So the experiments will be like that. So it's not really spherical experiment. It's a conical indentor. It was not a Berkovitch, it was really a spherocone. So it was a sapphire nano-indentor, which was axis symmetric, like this, just to get rid of the orientation of the wedges compared to the crystal orientation. If you have some correlation, you are dead. It will be very complicated. Okay. Here, since it's asymmetric, you just have the crystal orientation which enter into play, and not the wedges of the Berkovitch tip. So this is a spherocone tip, like that. So this is the angle, so similar to Berkovitch, to have the same surface area ratio. And the tip radius was quite big, 3 microns. So it means that up to 200 nanometers, it was like a sphere, and then it was linear. Okay. Then we will try the four single crystals. Those are again the stereographic projections of the normal to the indented surface, O1, 110, 123, which is more like single glide. This is more like multiple glide, multiple glide, multiple glide. Okay. According to what I explained you before, if you are in this axis, you know that you will activate simultaneously those two slip systems. When you are here, actually, you activate 8 potentially slip systems. All the neighbor slip systems here, there are 8. Here you have 6 systems which are activated simultaneously. And here you have 4. Okay. So depending where you are, you don't have the same number of systems which are active. The strain rate was controlled. It was 5 × 10⁻². And numerically, we try to do the same. So this is our mesh. So the mesh was the same as the real indenter. And we were able to go up to this amount of deformation, 1.4 micrometer. And then this is a trick for people who are doing FE modeling. If you want to do nano-indentation in the explicit mode, you need to be very careful of the velocity you apply to your tip. Because there is some inertial effect. You all know that inertia comes into play when you have some explicit method. So if you want to get rid of it, you should not say that your indentor moves at a constant velocity and you unload at a constant velocity. This doesn't work because when you unload, the material will still deform. You will have some overshoot of your loading. If you want to avoid that, you should have some velocity which is monitored that way. You first start to zero and you increase slowly. Then you have a constant velocity. And then you slow down before removing your indentor. See? So you need to account this thing. You cannot say it's this and then this. Because otherwise you have this inertial effect. So that's the trick, and then we can do it. Because if you don't do that, if you start typically from scratch, you apply this stress, there will be inertial effect. You need to put inertial, you know, you need to put into motion your material. So this will make some, it will have a delay. You have some transient mechanism. And the same when you will unload here, you unload, but the material will still go on deforming. So you will have an overshoot of your curve. It will not be a nice curve. You'll have something which is going out. Okay. Just because of numerics, just because of the mass of the material, which is in the explicit integration. So you have to be careful of that, but this is quite well known for dynamic modeling. So this is my, now you know this slide, but it should be before. So this is the device. So this was done not on my new indenter, it was a MTS XP, nano XP indenter that we have in the lab. So this is the force depth curve that you can measure out of indentation. We will see that this afternoon. Okay. So it looks like something like that. This is the case of 111 orientation. One of the two, I think this is the highest density guy, like this. So you load, you unload, like this. From the unloading part, you can measure the stiffness, which is the derivative of your curve. From the stiffness, you can also have with the continuous stiffness method, which is just adding an oscillation load on top of the curve. You have many value of the stiffness any times during the loading, so which gives you the what we call S, the stiffness during the depth, like this. We can measure after indentation the area, the residual area of your imprint by AFM. Here we look with AFM at the surface. From the ratio between the force and the residual area, we can get the hardness like that for all the orientations. Okay? That's the idea. And from the stiffness, we can get the Young modulus and this kind of thing. Okay? This is for the one-on-one. I can do the same for everything. So this is for all the tests. So you can visualize already some several features. The first thing you can see that the 111 with a low density is here. It means that this guy is a lot lower. It's here. You can see the hardness is very small. This is the hardness. I don't know what this guy looks like. It is laughing, you know. So this is my 111 with low indentation. It's here. If I take the same orientation with large dislocation, you see that the hardness is multiplied by factor 1.5. Okay. And those other orientations here. For 123, 110, and 01. Okay? So these are the data. We see that there is a strong effect of the dislocation density, clearly here, and the weak effect, I will say, of the orientation of the surface. Okay? That's the first conclusion. Not just qualitative here. Now, if I look at the surface, those are the AFM pictures of the same specimen. So this is 01 orientation. I told you this is the an orientation for which you have 8 systems which are activated, and you can see that this leads to a four-fold symmetry. So you have, those are the pileups. The yellow value are the height of your surface, which is high here and low there. Okay. So here you have pileups with a four-fold symmetry. If you apply along a 110, you have a two-fold symmetry, less close to a four-fold. 123, you have a main pileups here and very few remaining there. And for the 111, depending if you have a low density or a big density, you have something like a three-fold symmetry. And here, starting with a six-fold symmetry. Okay? So this is the data. This is the reality. I believe in the experiment, so this is reality. And now I want to check by FEM modeling what we can get using the model. So this is the model. You can see that it looks good. It looks very much similar to what we expect. So first, let's look at the effect of orientation. So I take the same data, same parameters. I took the what we call heterosem. So we should go back to my slide if you want to have a look. But heterosem is a choice of the two parameters, heterosem. So hetero and sem, so the red parameters here. I took this set of values, okay? And I got this orientation dependence, which is like that. So you mean that everything is constant, you just change the orientation of your crystal. You see the effect is very, very weak on the curve. There is just 3% difference at 1.5 micron. Only, I put micron, is not micron, so it's 1.5 micron. Yeah. So this is a 3% difference, very small effect of orientation, very weak. But now, if you look at the AFM, oops, I can see it here, there is a strong effect on the surface. Clearly here you have a four-fold symmetry for the O1. 110, you have a two-fold symmetry. 112, you have something which is like that. And 11, three-fold symmetry. Okay? So this means that the orientations play a big role at the surface, not on the loading curve. That's the first point. Okay? Then, if you look at the effect of the dislocation density, the initial one I put in the model, how much it starts with for the dislocation density, the continuous curve here are my experiments for the 111 with the low density and 111 with the high density. I did many FEM simulations, which are the point there, and I look which one is the closest to the experiment. And from that, I can select the dislocation densities corresponding to my two specimens. More or less, we can do better, but this is what we found. So typically we found that initially for the 1-1 low, we have 6 to the 12 dislocation density, which is quite already high. And for the high, we have 1 to the 14 dislocation density, okay? And if we do look at the surface, it's the numerical data, we see that for the high dislocation density, we have a three-fold symmetry. For a low, it's not really a six-fold symmetry, but nearly. You can see that they are not all detached, the lobe, but they are close to detached. Okay? What about the other orientation? If you have these two dislocation densities, can we do the same for all the samples? So we can have a look here. So the samples are fitted the same way here. And we optimize the dislocation densities. So we found that the optimized one was for 0.11 this amount, 1.11 this high this amount, 1.11 low, I showed you that before, and those for the two other orientations. So you can see that it ranges from 10 to the 12 to 10 to the 14, different, depending on your tested samples. Okay? This is just by the fitting of the loading curve. Again, with the hetero-same parameters. Now, this compares very well to the X-ray diffraction, because if I say that this is 1, 3, 10 to the 13, then I find that this is multiplied by 0.2, exactly what I found with X-ray full half medium peak measurements. This is 5 times bigger, 4 times bigger, 4 times bigger. This is exactly in the range that we expected out of the X-ray. So we are very happy with that. It means it is consistent. There is some consistency there. So first thing, we are very happy with this. Now, we want to look at the effect of the parameters. We are here to investigate the effect of all the parameters, hetero, Taylor, normal, same, high K, so all of the set of parameters I could check. You can see that on the loading curve, this has a small effect. There is an effect, but not so important, a small effect. But on the residual deformation, it's very big, the effect is very big. You see that this shape here is totally different from that shape there. So you have very strong effect of the constitutive equation, not on the loading curve, but on the surface. And this is something I want you to retain, if you want to retain something out of that lecture, is that with nano indentation, although you could have very bad constitutive equation, you can use a power law, for example, a Ludwig equation, you will always be able to fit that curve. That's very easy to fit such a curve. But if you look at the surface, you can have very, very bad measurements. It could be very, very wrong at the surface topology. So to have the two correct, you need a very good model. This is easy to do. This is not easy to do. Okay. And this is where the physics is hidden. And I will show you why. If we take now the experimental data corresponding to these parameters, 1-1 orientation, this is how it looks like. So I look among that pictures, which one is the closest. I say, okay, this looks to be that one. I say that this is something which is similar. You have this thing which is detaching a bit. So I think this is the best. You can take another one if you prefer, but this is the one we selected, which corresponds to hetero and same. And now we want to check if we keep the same for orientation, is it also good or not? And is it quantitative or is it just qualitative? So this is what we do for the comparison. Here the colors are exactly the same, okay? It's the same scale of colors for FEM on the left and experiments on the right. So you see that they compare very, very well. You have the four-fold symmetry with the same, let's say, zone of the peaks. They match very well. Experiments here also. Also for the lobe, here there's a small discrepancy, but not so bad. This, of course, you can rotate in the plane, but you can see that they could match. So we have something which is surprisingly good. So it confirmed that way that we should use those parameters, which actually corresponds to the one from Cuba and coworkers. They did a nice job in their DD modeling, a lot nicer than what I did a long time ago. So this paper, you can believe what they did in 2008. I think this is something you can trust. And if, just to convince you that this is indeed very, very much good, what we do is we do a path coming through, passing through all the pileups like this, and we plot the height of your surface during the path. So you have the FEM in dark blue, like this, and you have the experiments in clear blue. And you can see that the magnitude is very, is, of course, it's not one by one, it's not exactly the same, I agree, but there's some discrepancy, we can do better, we can make some more simulation and check better. But the magnitude is very much similar. I'm very happy when I see that. It means that the model is fine. I mean, we have something good in the model. You have something which compares very well. Okay, here also. Maybe you can change a little bit to get more the details of something like that. Typically for the 111. The 111, I think we should better play with the dislocation densities, but I think we have anyway the wavelength is good. The magnitude is not bad, but not exact, but not bad. So you see that it compares quantitatively, not only qualitatively, but also quantitatively. So if you take these parameters, we were able to reproduce exactly the copper single crystal that we had at the lab. So this is the conclusion for this experiment. With these parameters, and now I have access to the dislocation densities. Oops. Oops. Dislocation density, which are there. I know that if you use these parameters for the alpha, these parameters for the A, and these parameters for K, 36, according more or less to 2008, except for K, but this is what they published in this paper. Indeed, we can match very well and quantitatively all the data experimentally with our stupid FEM modeling based on dislocation densities. Okay. So here I would say that I can trust this model. This dislocation dynamics modeling, I think, is reliable. The physics is there because it was not computed for nano notation. It was built on this dislocation motion and so on. And it reproduced this nano notation test, which is quite complicated. This is not shear. It's a very free axial 3D stress field, which is the BNF indentor. It's in confined plasticity. It's a complex loading. Okay, state. So I hope I convinced you that this DD model, this dislocation density, yes, DD model, dislocation density model is very good to be used in crystal plasticity constitutive equations. Yes, please. Gradients? No. It's exactly the model as I presented. Yes, it's just statically stored dislocations, just dislocation densities. There is no length, no gradient. Yeah. It's just the model, exactly the model I present, this model here, exactly this one. Yeah. With the flow law. Which is, I don't hear with the noise. Excuse me. What? Yes, there is the size effect that we can try typically, but when you go up to 1.5 microns, the size effect doesn't exist anymore, so it's not a big issue here. Yeah. That's true, but I don't know if you are aware of that, but what he says that if you are familiar with nano indentation, there is something which people do not explain yet much, clearly, is that when you have a low penetration indentation, you find a hardness which is very high, compared to what if you get if you go very deep in your specimen. If you have a deep indentation, you have such a hardness. If you go low, you have a higher hardness. So there is what we call an indentation size effect. The hardness decreases with the penetration depth. This, now we can start to explain that with the dislocation dynamics code. I will show you that, the nano indentation test of dislocation dynamics code. With this one, I didn't try. Maybe we can have access, but I didn't try. Because, of course, we need to have a length. So we should put a length. Or gradients. Any other questions? Yeah, this we can do that. I didn't do, but I have the tools to do that. Yes, yeah. But I didn't analyze yet. Yeah. The night tensor. Yeah. The stiffness, yes, with the depth, yes. Yeah, yes. It has to be proportional to H. The stiffness is proportional to H in a conical indentation. Right? The stiffness, initially, yeah. It has to be a linear dependence on the, if I remember well. But this one here. Yeah, the stiffness has to be linear actually. It's the at unloading. Yes, exactly. Yes, it's dp over dh when you unload, and this has to be proportional to h, so it has to be aligned. So is it aligned here? Yes, more or less. It has to be linear. Yeah. Okay. Which this parameter with DD? Oh, this is next lecture. I will show you the how we compute that. Okay. Actually, it's just a statistic. As I told you, you cannot put a single family of dislocation because it will not make the job. If you put hard obstacle to dislocation, it will find a way to make it easy. So you need to have random forest, put your dislocation inside, and compute out of that the stress you need to push in order to make it pass through the obstacle. That's roughly the technique. Okay. But they also improved that to compute also the dislocation densities low, and I will show you what they did. This is not my work, so this is their work, but I will show you this also. I think it's tomorrow, this. Yeah. I don't want to do it now, because tomorrow I will not have anything to say. Okay, so I think I already spoke a lot, so maybe I think that's enough to stop here. Yes? From AFM, yes. Not when we go up to 1.4 micron, it's no more a sphere. Actually, there was the thing here. Here you see. It's a sphere up to 200 nanometers, but later on it's no more a sphere. This is why, if it was a sphere, by the way, the stiffness should not be linear. So this is the beginning. The spherical part is the what you see on the stiffness, this curvature. And then when it is linear, you are in the self-similar regime. Okay. The Berkovich tip, so maybe we will see this afternoon. Do you know what is indentation usually? What indentor do you have in mind? Berkovich is not the usual one. What is the indentor that people usually use to measure hardness? Spherical, no, this is Brinel. You have Brinel and you have what else? Rockwell and Vickers. Vickers, I think, is the most famous one, right? So Vickers is a four-side pyramid. Yes, you have a four-side pyramid like that. And when you do, so four-side pyramid, I will try to plot it. It will look like this. So this is my Vickers tip. Okay. So this is Vickers. The problem of Vickers is that if you want to do this at a very low, very precise measurement, low force, so low penetration, so you want to look exactly what happens when your material is deformed at that zone here. Okay. Then, locally, if you zoom on it, since you have 1, 2, 3, 4 planes, if you want to have 4 planes meeting in a point, it's theoretically impossible. Three planes meet and create a point. If you have 4 planes, you will have a line always. So at the end, here, you always get a small line. Okay? So people do not like Vickers because of that. So when they do nano-indentation, they prefer to have a three-side pyramid, like this, which is called Berkovich. So this is what we call Berkovich. It's not good to have put it that way. The Berkovich is like this. Okay, so three-side pyramid. And now three planes, when they enter into contact, it's a single point. So this is much more acute. The tip radius is much smaller. So people use Berkovich for the nano-indentation test. And your question, why is it not good either for the single crystal? Just because now, if locally my surface, if I put my Thomson tetrahedra on top of it, on my surface, I can say that this is my Thomson tetrahedra. For example, this is a 1-1-1 surface. Then you see that this Berkovich, depending on this wedge, if it falls collinear to that or there, you will just have some stress concentration that will depend on your crystallography. And this is, if you want to look at the pileups, then you are dead because the pileups will depend on this. You see. So we prefer to use this spherocone because of that. Okay. So this was made of sapphire. Because the sapphire is easier to machine as a conical indent. Diamond is more difficult. Usually the Berkovich is in diamond. And the spherocone is better to do that in sapphire. The problem with Sapphire is a bit soft. So typically we destroy the tip very, very, very quickly, not on copper, but later on we tested some metallic glasses and the tip was destroyed. It was plastified. Here I don't, yes, here it's written, it's rigid, but we tried both. Here it was a rigid, so it was a master curve. I think, I don't know how it's called, this was Abacus. I'm not a specialist of Abacus, my student did it. So I don't know how it's called, but there is a name for that, the master element, so I don't know something, you know. Anyway. So this was a rigid indenter that was going inside the specimen. And also locally, he did something very smart to make it run. Yes, this is a trick also. If you are dealing with this crystal plasticity model, you still have a problem. There's still an issue. If you are dealing with a spherocone, your surface is like here, okay? This is my surface. My spherocone is like that, okay? And then, since this is not symmetric, this is, here you have some crystallographic axis, you have this axis here. Very quickly, you will have some plastic slip in a given direction. First, it will not be exactly symmetric and you have something stable. It will be much unstable at the beginning. You have some glide, and then your material deforms suddenly. And this is very bad for the convergence, for the stability of your FEM. It doesn't work. So what he did that, he had all the zone here, was made of arbitrary Lagrangian Eulerian elements. So you have a mesh, which is fixed, and your material is moving inside the mesh, like in Eulerian framework. And then this was Lagrangian. This was ALE method, and this was Lagrangian. And this is a good trick to stabilize your simulations. If you don't do that, you have some instability and your code doesn't work. Okay. So don't forget to use ALE. It's a good thing in Abacus. It works fine. Yes. And you talk. Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, actually, there is still a debate on that. Initially, people were fighting on that when I was doing my PhD in the late 90s, close to 2000. People say that there is this indentation size effect, and you can find thousands of papers on that, where they plotted something like this. You have the hardness versus the depth. And they find something like that, okay? And up to something like, it could be up to 100 nanometers, typically for copper. And then it's still not much a constant. So this thing now is controversial because most of those papers finally appeared to be just because the shape of the tip was not properly measured. Because in the hardness measurements, you need to have an idea of what we call the function area. So to the area versus the depth, and this function area is assumed to be the contact with your sample during the load. You don't see during load what happens. So you need to exactly know at each point of your load, when you are doing your curve like this, you do this kind of thing and you unload. If you want the hardness at that point, you divide this force by the contact area. But the contact area should be taken here and not really there or there or there. So what people do is that they have, this is H, the depth, they have a function which gives you the contact area as the function of the depth, which is the area function. And this area function is something which is just actually this thing. You compute this area versus the depth. What is this area? Okay, this kind of thing. The problem now is that your material could look strange. So typically, in the case of copper, if you zoom on what happens, you have your indentation like this. You have your specimen which is like that. Then you have two different mechanisms. I can plot the two on the two sides. Either you have the material which is like this, and the contact area is starting here. It is what we call a sinking. The material is sinking in the sample. So the contact area is lower than if it was a perfectly, a perfect plastic material. Or you can have pileups. This is pileups. Okay. And what appears, and the DD simulation can show that, is that this mechanism changed at the beginning of the plasticity. So you cannot assume, okay, my material is always doing pileups, and I make some corrections of my contact area to account for that. This is what people are doing now, but it's not good because initially you may have first sinking and then pileups. So this contact zone is changing with the deformation. DD can show that very, very nicely. You see. But FEM also could show it, I guess. But experimentally, we don't have access to that. You cannot see in your indenter what happens. So this actually depends only on this analysis, which is called the Oliver and Farr analysis. This analysis assumes one of the two behaviors, but not a transient behavior between the two. And this, if you take this into account, maybe, and maybe this answers your question, maybe you would get a constant hardness. This, I believe, could be true. You see? So this is still a debate. I don't say that what I say here is the truth, but it's still a debate. It's still controversial. But size effect may not exist. Okay? Just need to be careful with your contact area, which is impossible to do with experiments. So you will have indentation size effect, but maybe it's an artifact of your analysis, actually.
I think the only way to do the experiment is to then look at the topography of each of your
intensity. AFM, this is what we did here. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. This is what we do here. Although you still have some small elastic recovery that may change a bit the value, but this is what we try to do here with AFM. But people remember that nano notation is supposed to be done without AFM. The idea is you make your indent and you have your hardness. If you, every time you make an indent, you have to look to the print. This is no more nano notation. But that's true. But theoretically, if you do that, at least the size effect is very low. You have a small size effect, but still there is some. Okay. So thank you for these interesting questions. Shall we stop here? Okay.